In this lesson, we'll discuss how to solve a set of nonlinear algebraic equations using the Newton-Raphson and modified secant methods. Sometimes a set of two or more nonlinear algebraic equations need to be solved simultaneously in order to make predictions about a physical system. Here are two random nonlinear equations with unknowns x1 and x2. The first equation is x1 squared plus x1 times x2 equals 10. The second equation is x2 plus 3 times x1 times x2 squared equals 57. We bring all terms to the left side of the equations, which makes the right side of the equations equal to 0. Notice that the left sides of the equations are functions of x1 and x2. We call the left side of the first equation f1 and the left side of the second equation f2. Our goal is to find a value of x1 and x2 that will make both functions equal to 0. If we plot the two nonlinear equations on a graph, where x2 is the y-axis and x1 is the x-axis, solving the set of two equations is equivalent to finding the point where the two curves intersect. In this case, the intersection point is where x1 is equal to 2 and x2 is equal to 3. A graphical method may be possible with two nonlinear equations, but it is too difficult to use this method if there are three or more nonlinear equations. More generally, we will have n equations and n unknowns. If just one of these equations is nonlinear, the entire set of equations is nonlinear. Each equation has the form of some function of n unknowns equals 0. We label the functions f1 through fn, and the unknowns are labeled x1 through xn. For brevity, we will sometimes omit the unknowns x1 through xn when writing the function names, but keep in mind that f1 through fn can be functions of all the unknowns. We now examine the multivariable Taylor series for the kth function, called fk, where k is some number in the range 1 to n. A change in fk, which is labeled as delta fk, is equal to the partial derivative of fk with respect to the first variable x1 times delta x1 plus the partial derivative of fk with respect to the second variable x2 times delta x2, and so on until we reach the partial derivative of fk with respect to the last variable xn times delta xn. There are also infinite number of other terms that have higher order derivatives multiplied by delta x1, delta x2, and so on raised to higher powers. We will make a linear approximation that delta x1 through delta xn are so small that the higher order terms are negligible. Just like in the Newton-Raphson and secant methods, the deltas refer to the difference between the current values of the variables, denoted by the subscript I, and the next estimate of the variables, denoted by the subscript I plus 1. For example, delta x1 is the difference between the next estimate for x1, labeled x1 I plus 1, and the current value for x1, labeled x1i. Delta xn is the difference between the next estimate for xn, labeled xni plus 1, and the current value for xn, labeled xni. Delta fk is equal to fki plus 1 minus fki. Fki plus 1 is the function k evaluated using the values of the variables at the next step, I plus 1. Fki is equal to the function k evaluated using the values of the variables at the current step I. The partial derivatives are given the subscript I since they are evaluated using the values of the variables at the current step. We bring the Taylor series approximation equation to the top of the screen and continue. Recall that ultimately we are trying to find the value of the variables xi through xn that makes the function fk equal to 0. So with this equation, we want to find the change in the variables required to make the value of fk at the next step, which is fki plus 1, equal to 0. So we set fki plus 1 equal to 0. Using this general equation, we can generate individual equations when k is equal to 1, k is equal to 2, all the way through k equal to n. These n differential equations are actually a set of linear equations. On the left, we have the functions f1 through fn evaluated at the current step I. We can calculate these equations since we know the variables x1 through xn at the current step. On the right, we have partial derivatives multiplied by delta x1 through delta xn. Since the partial derivatives are also evaluated at the current step I, we can calculate those quantities as well. This means the partial derivatives are simply coefficients to the unknown delta x terms. And notice that all the delta x terms are raised to the first power. There are no nonlinear terms. We can rewrite the n equations into matrix form. The n by n matrix of partial derivatives is called the Jacobian and represented by capital J. We can write the system of linear equations even more compactly as negative fi equals ji times delta x, where fi is a column vector containing the n functions evaluated at step I, ji is the Jacobian evaluated at step I, and delta x is a column vector containing the unknown step sizes. Since we are dealing with a system of linear equations, we can use techniques such as Gaussian elimination to solve for the delta x terms. Recall that delta x is the difference between the values of the variables at the next step I plus 1 and the value of the variables at the current step I. Once we obtain the delta x values, we can determine the revised values for the variables at the next step, xi plus 1. There are a couple methods for determining the elements of the Jacobian. The first method involves determining an expression for each partial derivative and evaluating those expressions at each step. For example, let's focus on partial f1, partial x1. And let's say that f1 is equal to x1 squared times x2 squared minus x3. Partial f1, partial x2 is equal to 2x1 squared times x2. This function would then be evaluated using the current values of x1 and x2. While this method is straightforward to implement, you would need to determine expressions for all the partial derivatives, which can be very time-consuming for large systems of equations or complicated functions. Since we are calculating derivatives to help us find the solution to nonlinear equations, this method is often referred to as a Newton-Raphson method. The second method involves estimating the partial derivatives using finite difference approximations. Once again, we use partial f1, partial x2 as an example. Since we want to know the rate f1 changes with x2, we can vary x2 by a small amount delta and calculate f1 at this modified value of x2, then subtract f1 evaluated at the original value of x2. This difference is divided by x2 plus delta minus x2, which simplifies to delta. As in the Newton-Raphson method, all the variables x1 through xn are the values at the current step I. Delta is some arbitrary small value set by the user, and notice that as delta approaches 0, we get closer to the actual value of the partial derivative. Since we are estimating derivatives using finite differences to help us find the solution to nonlinear equations, this method is often called the modified secant method. The phrase modified is used because we are slightly modifying one of the variables to estimate the derivative. Regardless of which method we use to calculate the elements of the Jacobian, we start with initial guesses for each of the n variables, which are stored in the vector x0. We can use these values to calculate the n functions, which are stored in the vector f0, and calculate the n squared elements of the Jacobian, which are stored in the matrix j0. Using Gaussian elimination or some other method, we can solve the set of linear equations negative f0 equals j0 delta x. This gives us vector delta x, which contains the adjustments that will be made to the variables. We add vectors x0 and delta x, giving us improved estimates of the variables, which are then stored in vector x1. The values in vector x1 are used to calculate the functions, which are stored in f1, and the elements of the Jacobian, which are stored in matrix j1. We solve this system of linear equations for the vector delta x and add delta x to the values in vector x1, giving us an improved estimate of the variables. This improved estimate is then stored in vector x2. We can continue this process many times to improve the estimate of the solution, but how do we know when to stop this process? One possible criterion for terminating the modified secant method involves a Euclidean norm of the function vector, which will be denoted as the vector f inside two sets of vertical lines and a subscript e. We can calculate the norm by summing the squares of all n functions, f1 squared plus f2 squared all the way through fn squared, then taking the square root of this summation. The Euclidean norm can be expressed more compactly as the square root of the summation of fj squared, where j varies from 1 to n. Each time you calculate the function vector, you also calculate the Euclidean norm. If the norm is below some small value epsilon that you get to set, say 10 to the negative 5, then you likely have found the values of the n variables that are very close to the actual solution.